So welcome everybody. Today we have our final popular science talk for the summer school, and it is my pleasure to invite our speaker, Dr. Radhika Gupta. Radhika is a mathematician, and as you could have guessed from her title, she's a geometer. She's currently a postdoctoral researcher at Temple University in Philadelphia. She did her undergraduate studies at IIT Bombay, and then she did her PhD at the University of Utah, which is around the time I met Radhika first. If you want to know more about her journey, feel free to ask her after her talk. But until then, Radhika, the room is yours.
Okay, thank you very much. I want to thank the organizers for the opportunity to speak. So I'll start my talk. And if you have any questions, you should feel free to just like stop me in the middle and ask them or write them on the chat. I'll try to check my chat.
I'll just interrupt you, Radhika. I'll moderate the chat so you don't have to worry. I'll let you know, okay?
Okay. So, okay. Okay. So, for a long time, humans or people, we thought that Earth was flat or Earth is flat. And then they eventually realized that, oh, actually Earth is a sphere and it's not flat. So the geometry of where we live is very different from how we perceive it from our local point of view versus from, like, let's say if we zoom out, then Earth is actually flat. And then you can ask the question, so we think we live in three space. But then if you zoom out more, what is the geometry of the universe? Is it the same, or is it the same as how we perceive our local world? Or is there something funny happening when you like zoom out a lot in the universe? So in this talk, I want to give you a glimpse of the possible geometries that exist, and then see if we can, and then like from that, we can choose what geometry the universe can have. So my first question is, what is a geometry? So it's just one quick question. Can I see, I know like, instead of seeing myself, can I see the other people, even though the video is above?
Yeah, so if you look, do you have the view tab above?
Yeah.
So in that, if you go to like gallery mode, you'll be able to
see. Now I see. Yeah, this is much better.
And not a lot of, I mean, people don't have their videos on, but you can encourage them to have their videos on. But
that's okay. I think the spotlight is on the host. That's why that goes away, I think.
Oh, so you're not, the gallery mode doesn't stay?
Okay, I think it's saying now.
Okay, great.
Yeah, cool. No, I think, yeah, it's, even if it's like black boxes, at least some people have their pictures. So,
right, okay.
Better than seeing myself.
Okay. Sure.
Sorry. Okay, so my first question is, before we like try to understand or try to question, what is the geometry of the universe? What is a geometry? Would anyone like to answer? Like when I say the word geometry, what comes to your mind? You can just say some words.
Related to shapes.
Shapes, great.
A study of figures, points, lines, and surfaces.
Exactly, perfect. So this is what that is. Arrangement of things, right? We think of relative position of objects, and that's what we think of when someone says geometry. I think this picture captures a lot of what geometry was for us or is for us until school. In school, this is what geometry is for us. Triangles and circles and drawing things by compass and ruler. And as some of you said, geometry of a space is concerned with properties related to distance between two points, shape of objects, size, relative position. That's what geometry is. The geometry we are most familiar with, again, the one we learn in school, is geometry in the plane. We also study R3 in the space, but let's focus on just two dimensions for this talk. So we are most familiar with geometry in the plane. We know how to find distance between two points. So we have this formula, distance between two points. We know what's the shortest path between two points, and that's the straight line for us. You know, it's the straight line between two points. And I want to introduce a new word called geodesic. So the shortest path between two points is called a geodesic between those two points. So it's just a new word. The image in our mind is straight line between two points. There are other things we know about the space, about the geometry in the plane. We can find angle between two straight lines. We know what is the notion of angle. We know sum of angles in a triangle is pi. And we know this, the plane is flat. It's not curving or doing anything else. It's very flat. So I say curvature is zero and the space is flat. So this space has a name. We just say plane, but this space actually has a name called Euclidean. Like this kind of geometry is called Euclidean geometry. And all the theorems and results that we learn about this the geometry we learned in school were actually laid by Euclid in his treatise called Euclid's Elements around 300 BC. It's like a 13 book thing. So he laid out some rules which are satisfied in Euclidean geometry. And then using those rules, you can derive a lot of theorems. Like sum of angles in a triangle is pi. You can derive that from like some sort of rules that he laid down. So that's called Euclidean geometry after Euclid, who laid down some rules. I want to draw your attention to a particular rule that Euclid said. Euclid said, you assume that's a rule in your space. And that is Euclid's fifth postulate. Before I say that, I just want to remind you, when are two lines parallel? When they don't intersect. So that's my definition of two lines being parallel, that they don't intersect. Okay, so what is Euclid's fifth postulate? Euclid's fifth postulate is you're given a line L and you're given a point P not on the line. Then the postulate or the rule is that there is exactly one and only one parallel line passing through P. There's one and only one line passing through P that is parallel to the given line. And we know that's true in Euclidean space or the plane we are familiar with. So this is one of Euclid's rules that this geometry should satisfy. So this is called his fifth postulate. And I guess now I want to ask you, can you think of a space where this is not true? That if I give you a line, a straight line, if I give you a line and I give you a point, and then I ask you, can you find more than one or no parallel lines through that point? So let me show you the fifth postulate again, if you want to think about this for a second.
Adhika, there are some answers in the chat box, or there is an answer in the chat box.
Oh yeah, nice. Oh yeah, so someone said sphere, and that's perfect. That is the answer I was looking for. So in a sphere, so let's see, let's elaborate on that example. So our claim is that Euclid's fifth postulate is not true in the sphere. So to understand that, let me say a few words about spherical geometry. So spherical geometry, so now I am on my space is a sphere. I know it lives in three space, but I am living on the sphere. So the three space is irrelevant to me right now. So I'm living on Earth and I just want to see what's the geometry, what do the lines look like and what is the shortest path between two points and angles and things like that. So first I want to know what is the shortest path between two points. So if you think about the North Pole and the South Pole, so what we know about the Earth should help you think what's the shortest path from the North Pole to the South Pole. So that would be a longitude. Longitudes will give me shortest paths from North Pole to South Pole. And what's a longitude? Longitude is basically an arc of a great circle. A great circle is a circle whose center is the center of the sphere. So in fact, in this space, the shortest path between two points is an arc of a great circle containing those two points. So now these shortest paths are my straight lines. In the plane, the straight line is the shortest path between two points. And on the sphere, these shortest paths are actually curved. So I can say that these straight lines are actually curved in spherical geometry. So we want to say shortest path is a straight line, but the geometry is different. So the straight lines actually look curved from our Euclidean eye. Because we are looking at the sphere in three space. So we think, oh, these are curved. But this person living on Earth, they think it's actually the straight line on that sphere. So here is a question that you should, if you get bored of my talk, you can think about this. I just claimed that between any two points, there is a great circle that passes through any two points. So you should think, why is that true? Why is there always a great circle passing through any two points? Like if I give you two points on a latitude, so I'm saying that's not the shortest path. Unless it's the equator is a great circle. So this is the shortest path between X and Y. But if I take any other latitude and I take two points, this is not the shortest path. I have to find a great circle passing through those two points. So you should think about why that's true. Okay, so I'm trying to understand this geometry. So now I know what do paths look like. I want to know what do angles look like. Well, angles come from Euclidean, because the sphere lives in the three space, which I do understand from the Euclidean perspective. The angles just come from, if I draw these lines, tangent lines to these two arcs, and then I can just measure the angle in the three space. Okay, now I want to draw triangles. Triangles are formed by, I take three points and I draw straight lines between those three points, right? That's how I draw a triangle. And here, what is a straight line? A straight line is a great circle. So that's why I have my triangle. So this is my triangle and it actually looks fat. It's not a flat triangle, it looks fat. And the sphere has positive curvature. It's actually curving. What about parallel lines? There are no parallel lines. If you take any two straight lines, again, my straight lines are these great circles. If I take any two of them, they will always intersect. So there are no parallel lines, which means Euclid's fifth postulate is false for trivial reasons. Because if I take, if I take the North Pole, and if I take this line L, the equator, any great circle I draw through the North Pole is always going to intersect the equator. So there, no two lines are parallel. So Euclid's postulate is false for trivial reasons, just because there are no parallel lines. So that's a answer, but it's not very convincing, because the fifth postulate failed for trivial reasons. Like, oh, there are no parallel lines, so what do I do? So the next question is, is there a space where Euclid's fifth postulate fails? Not because there are no parallel lines, but because there are infinitely many parallel lines that I can draw. So in fact, until the late 18th century, mathematicians were actually trying to think, or they actually believed that maybe fifth postulate is redundant. Maybe the rules that Euclid laid down for Euclidean geometry, you can derive fifth postulate from his other postulates. So they were doing a lot of hard work to try to prove this. But in late 1820s, these three mathematicians independently, they realized there exist geometries that do not satisfy this parallel axiom. And when I say they realized there exist geometries, they were not considering the sphere, because in some sense the sphere is still sitting in the Euclidean space, and we understand Euclidean space where the fifth postulate is true. So they wanted something more, something like a real example where Euclid's fifth postulate would fail. So these three guys independently figured out that there is a geometry which is not Euclidean. So, and this was a breakthrough, like finding the, or showing that there exists a non-Euclidean geometry was a scientific revolution, which fundamentally changed how mathematicians and scientists think. Because until then, you only had Euclidean geometry, basically, nothing else. People thought space was Euclidean. There was no other kind of space. There was nothing else to work with. And once they realized there exists something which does not follow the rules of Euclidean geometry, it basically like blew up everyone's mind. And for good reason, people were actually very skeptical. These three people came up with this around the 1820s, but only by the 60s, late 60s, people actually, until for like those many, like what, 40 years, people were like, oh, sure, you think something exists, but does it really exist in real life? Like, how do we believe you? And then Beltrami came up with a model of hyperbolic space. What do I mean by a model of hyperbolic space? This is like drawing a map of hyperbolic space in Euclidean space. It's like, we know Earth is a sphere, but we draw maps of the Earth on piece of paper so that we can understand what's going on the Earth, on this spherical object. Similarly, you can draw a map of hyperbolic space in Euclidean space so that we can understand what's going on. Sorry, I'm using the word hyperbolic. So Felix Klein coined the term hyperbolic geometry for this non-Euclidean space that these guys came up with. So Beltrami came up with a model or a map of hyperbolic space in Euclidean space, and Felix Klein also came up with a different map. So there are multiple ways of viewing this hyperbolic geometry, which is fundamentally very, very different through our Euclidean eye. And the next thing I want to do is I want to tell you about one model of the space called the Poincaré disk. I just want to stress again that until these guys, people thought everything is Euclidean. Everything works the way we think it works locally in our world. And then they're like, oh, actually there's a lot more. Or what if, once you know such a thing exists, you're like, oh, what if I zoom out a lot more? My world is not Euclidean. My world is maybe hyperbolic. And then our intuition is very wrong. It's like when we thought Earth is flat versus when we thought, oh, Earth is a sphere. Those are very different. Things behave very differently that way. Since if our world was hyperbolic, it would be, might look like how we believe, but zooming out, it could be behaving very differently. So now I want to tell you about a particular model or a particular map of hyperbolic space. And what do I mean by a map? I'm trying to draw hyperbolic space in Euclidean space so that I can understand it, because my eyes only understand Euclidean. So I'm trying to draw a picture in Euclidean space. So under this model, I'm talking about a specific hyperbolic space. I'm talking about hyperbolic space in two dimensions. I'm talking about the hyperbolic plane now. You can define hyperbolic space in three dimensions, four dimensions, and so on. But in this talk, I'm just talking about the two-dimensional hyperbolic space. So in this model, I'm going to map this mysterious hyperbolic space onto a disk in, I'm using a symbol which I didn't define. This is the Euclidean plane. and I am drawing some, so I've here shown some triangles which are tiling the sphere, and it's very distorted. In what sense? So if I have, so here is my ant. So I have an ant who lives on the hyperbolic sphere. Okay, there's a question. Are hyperbolic trigonometric functions related to hyperbolic space? I think they show up in the geometry of hyperbolic space, but I think they come from complex analysis, if I'm not wrong. When you do trigonometry on hyperbolic space, which is possible to do, I think these hyperbolic trig functions do show up. Okay. So I want to understand this hyperbolic space, and how do I understand a new space? I walk around. I try to explore. I go on exploration. So this is my ant, which lives on a hyperbolic space, and it wants to go on an exploration. So as this ant will walk around, it will actually see that these triangles are the same size. So to my Euclidean eye, they look as if they're getting smaller and smaller. But in hyperbolic space, all these triangles have the same size. And if I try to draw these hyperbolic triangles as the same size in Euclidean space, actually my disk would start to resemble a floppy hat, because I have to fit in a lot of triangles in small space. Like Euclidean space doesn't have that much room. So it'll start buckling. And it'll look like a floppy hat, and it'll buckle more and more because I'm just having to fit so many more triangles of the same size. So when I'm drawing it in Euclidean space, I'm drawing them to be getting smaller. But for this ant walking in hyperbolic space, these triangles are all the same size, which also means that the boundary of this circle, of this disk, sorry, this circle is at infinity. Because if I start walking, this ant starts walking, it will see infinitely many triangles of the same size. So the boundary of this disk is at infinity. So this space is infinite. The next thing I want to understand in this space is, what is the shortest path between two points? So here I've drawn two points, P and Q, and I want to understand what is the shortest path between these two points. So there's a question, is there a way that we can actually graph hyperbolic plane? Could you say what you mean by graph? Because to me, the picture I'm showing you right now is a graph of, in some sense, this is a graph of hyperbolic plane.
Graph means for me, like I'm saying that can we visualize it, or like in any software or something that we can see it with some axis or like that stuff?
With some axis? So there is another model of hyperbolic two space, which, do I have the picture here? Yeah. So this picture that I've drawn, this is another model or another map of hyperbolic plane. And here it's basically, this is X and Y, and I'm only looking at the positive upper half plane, but here the distances are different again. So,
Muskan's also asking if you can somehow view it in three dimensions, like you viewed the sphere, like that. Is there any way to embed it in?
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, okay, that was a question. So no, that is not true. Thank you for asking that question. I cannot do that because hyperbolic plane is intrinsically just, it's a new kind of geometry where Euclid's fifth postulate will not be true. So if I could embed it, it's intrinsic. So I'll say some more words. So hyperbolic space is just like very different from Euclidean space or three space. So you cannot really make it sit inside.
Thank you.
Like you can draw a piece of it, like the Yeah, I'll say it and then we'll come back to this. It's like when you have a horse saddle, a horse saddle has a hyperbolic behavior. So that horse saddle I can draw in Euclidean space. But if I want to draw this like infinite hyperbolic plane, that I cannot do in R3. Can hyperbolic planes be made up of convex polygons? So I guess when you say convex polygons, do you mean Euclidean convex polygons or hyperbolic convex?
No, I mean Euclidean convex polygons, because that's what I've heard.
No. Yeah.
Okay, I got it.
The space is inherently very different.
But these shapes individually look like not concave polygons, convex polygons. Like they, if I take two endpoints and draw a line, that wouldn't lie in that space.
If I take two points and take a line, then
that line would be outside the shape.
That line would be outside the.
Take a black.
Yeah. Oops. Yeah.
Take two corner points, the shorter ones.
Mm-hmm.
Draw a straight line. That would be outside.
Yeah. So again, when you say draw a straight line, you are thinking draw a straight line according to my Euclidean eye.
Okay. Yeah.
But in hyperbolic space, a straight line has a different meaning. Like the shortest path between two points or a straight line is actually what is drawn here. Yeah. So when you talk about convexity, you have to talk in terms of hyperbolic. So I haven't told you the distance or a metric on the space. So there is a metric on the space where the distances are not what we think they are. The distances will get distorted. And that I'm trying to show by these triangles, like this triangle and this triangle. They have the same area in hyperbolic metric.
Yes, ma'am, I got it.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
So let me say what are the shortest paths in this space. So I'm starting with, so take this for a fact that all these triangles have the same area. All these triangles are congruent in hyperbolic space. Okay, and then if I want to walk from point P to point Q, what's the shortest path? So if I try to go inside, if I try to go this way, I will be crossing many more triangles. If I go further deep, I will be crossing so many more triangles. And assuming that all these triangles are the same size, it's much better for me to walk closer to the center. If I walk closer to the center, that's when I will cross the least number of triangles. So geodesics or shortest paths in this space look like these arcs. And these arcs that are at 90 degree. Now when I say 90 degree, I mean in the Euclidean sense. So these arcs, they are the shortest paths. So the closer you are to the, like here, if I have these two points, and if I want to walk between them along the shortest path, I should walk this way. Because if I walk this way, I'm crossing two of the long sides of these triangles. But if I go inside, if I go further towards infinity, I will have to cross so many more triangles. So shortest paths in the space look like these arcs that are 90 degree angles. So I'm not proving anything for you at this point. I'm just telling you what is this map. Okay. So then when somebody was asking the question about convexity and they were saying, oh, if I draw a straight line, then it's actually outside the triangle. So this triangle does not look convex. So this triangle is actually convex in hyperbolic space. Because what does it mean to be convex? You have to think of straight lines, right? You draw straight lines and then, but straight lines here are these curved things in this map. So you have to, when you talk about convexity, you have to talk in terms of these geodesics. Then I've also drawn some angles in the triangle here. And it turns out that in this space, the sum of angles in the triangle is actually less than pi. So it's not pi. So in Euclidean space, it's pi. In sphere, it's more than pi. So your triangles look fat. And in hyperbolic space, the sum of angles is less than pi. So the triangles look thin. The notion of angle is the same. The notion of angle is the same as in Euclidean space. So if I want to know, I should have said this first before saying sum of angles. The angle between these two, I would draw a tangent line pretending it's in Euclidean and then measure the angle the way I would do in Euclidean space. So the word here is conformal, if you know that word, but if you don't, then forget about it. What else? And then the curvature of the space is negative because the sum of angles of a triangle is less than pi. The triangles are thin. Your triangles are actually looking like this. These are thin triangles. So I would say whatever curvature means, whatever intuition we have for curvature, I'm not defining it here, that is negative. Are there any more questions about, it's not at all intuitive if this is the first time you're looking at this space, because we are so tuned to thinking of Euclidean space. We are just always thinking, what if I draw this straight line, or what about this angle? And because we just think Euclidean, we are so tuned to thinking Euclidean. This was a cool fact. So I think when hyperbolic geometry, people discovered hyperbolic geometry, some people were against it. They thought this is not true and this should, some people were like, we should teach it in school, we should change the curriculum. And some people were like, oh no, you should not teach this in school curriculum because we don't know if it's true or not. And Lewis Carroll, who wrote Alice in Wonderland, he actually wrote a essay on why it should not be taught in school. which I thought was interesting. Because when I was preparing this talk, I was also searching how to teach hyperbolic geometry. And there are a lot of cases, a lot of reports, which are why we should teach hyperbolic geometry in school.
Nikita has a question for you.
In the chat?
No, so Nikita, go ahead and ask.
Okay, so I'm asking the center that we have. You've said that the closer we are to the center, the lesser the path will take to move from P to Q. So the center is on the top as an Euclidean form. I see it in the middle.
Yes.
So it's in the middle of that thing, or it's on the top of that thing, hyperbolic thing? As in a sphere, the center is inside. It's again.
Yes.
It's inside or it's on the top?
It's inside. So the model that I'm drawing here, it's a disk. So it is in the Euclidean space, it's just a disk. Just a flat disk. It's not buckling up. I know in the picture it looks like it's so I guess you are imagining it like this. Is that?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So I know. So when I'm drawing this picture, I'm just drawing a flat disk. And then I've changed the metric on that disk. I've changed how I measure distances.
Okay.
But yes, when I say the center, I am still thinking center in the sense of just that disk in Euclidean sense.
I get it, ma'am.
Yeah, Yeah, so I'll just say this again. I'm trying to draw a model of hyperbolic 2 space in Euclidean 2 space. So And which amounts to basically taking your usual 2 space, but then changing how you measure distances, completely messing it up. And when you do that, your space becomes very floppy. So let's see why the Euclid's fifth postulate fails in this space. So here I have a point P. Here I have a line. And can I find how many, or can I find parallel, can I find more than one parallel line passing through the point P? And I said the straight lines. Straight lines or hyperbolic straight lines are arcs at 90 degrees to the boundary of the disk. So I can actually draw, so now I can draw infinitely many arcs through this point that are, so I can draw infinitely many lines through that point P, or infinitely many straight lines, infinitely many hyperbolic straight lines that are parallel to this line. Parallel meaning they don't intersect the given line L. So Euclid's fifth postulate fails here, and fails here in a very bad way. Not that I found 2 parallel lines, but I found infinitely many parallel lines. So the space is fundamentally very different. From Euclidean space. Okay. So Purvi, how much, am I out of time or can I take a few more minutes?
No, absolutely, take it. I mean, it's like 8:40, but you can take a few more minutes so you can complete.
Okay, so I'll take 5 more minutes and then just wrap up.
I mean, so we technically have time until 9 o'clock, and generally we leave some time for interaction. So go ahead, no problem. We started a little late as well, so it's fine.
Okay. Okay. So I wanted to show you some examples in real life. So, Pringles or chips, we have all eaten chips. Or a saddle. I don't know how many of us have sat on a horse, but I think we've seen a saddle. So a saddle has some of this negative curvature or like hyperbolic behavior that I was talking about. Like if I draw a triangle on the saddle shape, it looks thin. And if you actually go and measure these angles, they will turn out to be less than pi. So I can draw the saddle in 3 space. But if I forget there is 3 space, if I just live on the saddle, it would look like hyperbolic space. It would have hyperbolic features to it. It's not the hyperbolic plane that I was talking about, but every point in the hyperbolic plane feels like a saddle point. That might give you some intuition for what hyperbolic plane is. So every point will feel like a saddle point, and which is why I cannot put the whole hyperbolic plane in Euclidean space. If every point feels like a saddle point, that is not true for Euclidean space. That's very much not true for Euclidean space. Here's some art showing hyperbolic geometry. So Taina Taimina, she's a mathematician at Cornell. I think she attended a talk on hyperbolic geometry where the speaker was trying to make paper models, which were very floppy. And then she decided she would crochet these hyperbolic spaces. And these are like very famous now. Corals in the coral reefs, they have hyperbolic feature because they buckle a lot and they have some negative curvature and some hyperbolic feature. And I guess here it's a crochet representation of corals. In this picture, I guess she's trying to show the failure of fifth postulate. Here is one line, and here are multiple other ones which are parallel to the given line. M.C. Escher is a, so you should Google M.C. Escher. I don't have much time to talk about him, but he has like lots of lovely artwork. He was also motivated by hyperbolic geometry to make this kind of artwork. So that was all just fun kind of thing, but there is some relation between hyperbolic space and special relativity. I'll just say the word Minkowski space without really saying anything more, but there's something called Minkowski space that you use to study special theory of relativity, and Minkowski space also has hyperbolic features. So it actually shows up in physics as well, and not just for fun, in a fundamental way. Okay, so far we have learned about, well, we already knew about Euclidean geometry, or the high school geometry, then we have some intuition for spherical geometry. Then I told you a little bit about hyperbolic geometry. And then if one wonders, is there anything else? If I just stick to two dimensions, can I find more geometries which are fundamentally different from each other? And thankfully, no. Otherwise, we will just keep looking and there will be no end. So every surface, so a two-dimensional space, I have to add some adjectives to make the statement true, but let's not worry about those adjectives. So let's just say every two-dimensional space can be given one of these three geometries, Euclidean, spherical, or hyperbolic. Again, like there are some adjectives which are very important. So if you give me a random two-dimensional space, maybe I can break it up into pieces such that each piece will be either Euclidean, spherical, or hyperbolic. But then I can glue those pieces together. But literally there is only these three things to understand and nothing else, which is pretty cool. Then we can be like, okay, I understand. If somebody hands me a two-dimensional object, I can actually understand it completely. And I don't have to think about, oh, what if there is something else? Or what if this is something new that I never saw? So that's pretty awesome. But we live in three dimensions and we want to understand our universe. That was the goal. So far I didn't talk about three dimensions because three dimensions is hard. Is there a question?
Ma'am, like 90 degree in a Euclidean plane looks completely different from the 90 degree in a hyperbolic plane. So how are the angles actually measured in this hyperbolic plane?
Yes, thank you for asking. So in Euclidean space, if I want to measure angle between, let's say I have two arcs, not straight lines in, let's say I'm in Euclidean, okay? So when I draw two axes, I mean I'm in Euclidean space. If I draw two arcs, how do I measure the angle between two arcs? Well, I draw the tangent line to these two arcs. And then I measure the angle between those two tangent lines.
Okay, ma'am, I got it.
Yeah.
So thank you, ma'am.
Yeah. So I was talking about three-dimensional space. So we would like to understand our universe, and it would be good if we could make a list like this for the possibilities that the universe can have or a three-dimensional space can have. And in fact, this great mathematician, Thurston, you should look up more about him, you should read more about him. He conjectured in 1982 that every three-dimensional topological space it should say which cannot be. So there is some notion of breaking a space into simpler pieces. And then if you take a piece that you cannot break in whatever sense, then every three-dimensional topological space can have only one of eight options. It can be only one of eight geometries. just for the heck of it, I have the list, which won't mean much to us, except that we can maybe, so Euclidean spherical and hyperbolic is in that list. And then there are some more fancy things in that list. But the awesome thing is that somebody gives you a three-dimensional space, which is unbreakable in whatever piece sense that I'm talking about. You cannot chop it up into smaller pieces. Then there are only 8 options to choose from. So he conjectured this in 82. And then in 2003, Perelman actually proved that this is true. So in some sense, we also understand three-dimensional topological spaces up to this, like, yeah, we understand the unbreakable pieces. And interesting fact about, well, I'm sure there are more interesting facts about Perelman, but he proved this awesome thing and another really old conjecture, but he refused the Fields Medal and Millennium Prize and everything. And he lives in the mountains in the Alps somewhere. He was like, I don't care about all this money and prizes. So I guess these are the options we have to choose from. And then just wrapping up, just want to remind you again, locally we behave as if we are living on a flat surface. Then we zoom out, we realize, oh, actually we are living on a sphere, which has very different geometry. And then the question is, if you zoom out more, or how much do you zoom out to understand the universe? And if you zoom out more, what kind of geometry do you think the universe has? Is it Euclidean, hyperbolic, spherical? People believe it's Euclidean, but they really don't know, because they don't know how much they have to zoom out to be sure that it's not something else. So I'm still leaving you with the question, what is the geometry of the universe? Thank you.
Thank you, Radhika. It was a beautiful talk. And now you can either put it in the chat box or we already have a question. So Shami, you can unmute yourself and go ahead.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
At the previous slide, you showed a magnesium. Can you hear me?
Swami, your voice is breaking a little.
Am I audible?
Okay, let me switch off my video for a second. Can you say again?
Ma'am, am I audible?
Yes.
In the previous slide, you showed a geometry like Neil geometry.
I'm sorry, I think I'm not able to understand. Do you mind typing in the chat?
I mean, do you want to type your question in the chat? Okay, I think she's doing that.
Yeah.
Maybe we can go ahead with Shubhashree's question in the meantime.
Ma'am, am I audible?
Yes.
Thank you, ma'am. It was a great lecture. The first thing is, I'm a physics student and I have been reading relativity. I'm not reading relativity, but I have been watching videos on relativity.
Mm-hmm.
They imagine the space-time as a four-dimensional Euclidean space, which is actually contradicting from the non-Euclidean Minkowski. I don't know if I'm pronouncing it right. If it is right, or are they teaching me wrong in something? I have not been formally educated relativity. I will get it only in third year. I am in first year. So am I wrong, or is there a way we can trace between Euclidean and non-Euclidean geometry?
So I was also a physics. My bachelor's was in engineering physics, but I don't remember much. What I do remember is, I think when you study, isn't the light cone, don't you say like x square plus y square plus z square minus t square is one? Like, isn't, I think the light cone is supposed to be like a higher dimensional version of hyperbolic paraboloid. And I think that's the Minkowski cone or space.
I have not been studying it formally. I just have seen visualizations of it in YouTube. That's what I'm asking. They said me to visualize it as a four-dimensional Euclidean geometry. That's why I got confused when you said that it is not.
So I was I was referring to the the picture that I've seen is you have this light cone picture where you draw the present, past, and future. And I think that is supposed to be somehow related to hyperbolic.
So is there a way we can relate between Euclidean and non-Euclidean geometry?
I guess through these maps, I was drawing this Poincaré disk for you, where I was trying to draw this hyperbolic space. I was trying to draw its map in Euclidean space. So in that sense, maybe I think yes.
I'm sorry if I'm repeating it. Are they both the same? If I visualize it in four-dimensional Euclidean geometry and also in Minkowski space, I'm not able to pronounce that. Sorry. If I visualize in both, are they the same or am I getting something wrong in four-dimensional geometry? I don't really know relativity very much. But is it good to proceed by visualizing it in four-dimensional geometry?
So unfortunately, I don't remember enough to say yes or no to that question, if they are same or not. I'm sure I'll say something wrong if I say yes. It might be a question of whether you are living on the space or if you're, no. I want to say that they are not the same, and you're probably looking at a projection of that space in four dimensions or something like that.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
I'm not 100% sure. Sorry.
Thank you, ma'am.
So maybe we can take Shami's question from the chat box first before. So she says, ma'am, can you please tell a few words on nil geometry? It sounds very interesting and it is new also.
Okay, you're asking me hard questions. I think nil geometry has something to do with something called nilpotent groups, but I don't know much. Yeah, I mostly study hyperbolic geometry.
Basically it's too complicated to answer at this stage.
Yeah, I feel like there are too many words there that I don't know it well enough to give a simple explanation. And then if I use too many fancy words, then it's not helpful.
Okay, so we can maybe move on to the next question. So Kirvan, you had a question, you can go ahead and ask.
Yes, ma'am. Good morning, ma'am. Good evening, ma'am. So my question is, you've spoken about different types of geometries, right? So is there a general equation or a formula or anything that unifies all of these geometries? Or can we make a relationship between these types of geometries?
I guess yes, in some sense. Let me give you one example. Let's see. Yeah, so I'm thinking of hyperbolic plane, and if I look at this model or map of hyperbolic plane,
yes, ma'am.
I have two coordinates, x and y.
Okay.
And if I want to find the distance between two points, let's say x1, y1, x2, y2, the Euclidean distance, let's call it dE. I know the formula for Euclidean distance is x1 minus x2.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
And the hyperbolic distance between these two points would be this the same guy. So let me just write the square root divided by, okay, if I have to say this formula, let's just assume y1 is equal to y2, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Just so that I can give you a formula. It's different if y1 is not equal to y2.
Okay.
Divided by y squared. So I can give a formula for distance in hyperbolic space in terms of the x and y from the Euclidean. And the formula is different by this y squared. So that's an example.
Yes, ma'am. But I'm asking if it can be there for all in general, or can we establish relations between only certain types of geometries?
So I guess I want to say all, because the way we understand these other geometries is by mapping them to Euclidean geometry. So I think for most of them, I guess there are formulas where you can write the distance between two points in the other geometry in terms of Euclidean. But the formula will be different for each space,
yes,
for each geometry. Yeah, you will have a different formula. Like already, this formula will be different if I'm using this model. Like the formula will look something else. So the formula will depend on your model, but you will have formulas for each model, yes.
Yes, ma'am, okay. Yeah. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Ma'am?
Yeah?
Are quadratic forms related to hyperbolic geometry?
Are quadratic forms related to? I don't think so, not in any obvious manner.
Okay, ma'am, thank you.
Yeah.
Are there other questions or comments?
Ma'am?
Yeah?
Can we visualize the coordinate system of hyperbolic geometry? I mean, does it have a coordinate system like we have in case of an Euclidean geometry?
So again, this model that I was drawing, in this model, it's much easier to say what's the coordinate system. I can just use the coordinates x, y for points.
But similar as we use in Euclidean geometry.
Yes.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah. It's just that the distance between two points will be different than Euclidean. But if I have to say what point, I can still use x, like the, yeah. So actually I'll use a fancy word. Just so that I can say something precise, but ignore it if you haven't heard of it. So H2 is homeomorphic to R2. So what that means is I have this hyperbolic plane and I have this Euclidean plane. If I forget the distance between any two points, if I just look at those two spaces as sets, like as a collection of points, then they are the same. What the difference between those two spaces is how I measure the distance. Yeah. So when you want to have a coordinate system, you can use the same coordinate system. It's just that how you will measure distances will change. And that will also change your shortest paths.
Is this homeomorphic similar to the one we use in group theory in case of groups?
Yes. Yeah, so for groups, you use the word isomorphic. And it's homeomorphism is playing a similar role here for topological spaces, yes.
Other questions? All right. So, Radhika, I'm inviting them on your behalf to write to you if they have questions later.
Yes,
on. Or you can write to us and I'll forward their questions to you.
Yes. I can also try to answer the hard questions.
Yeah, maybe. So, right. So, that, Right. So first of all, I would actually encourage them to do some Google searching on their own. So, you know, you've dropped so many nice references. So any question you have that, you know, go ahead and that's a good habit in general. But if you still have any other questions that come to you tomorrow, day after, 3 days later, let us know and I'll definitely forward them to Radhika. But otherwise, let's just all thank Radhika for this wonderful talk. So
thank you, everyone.
And yeah, there'll be some comments. So thank you for introducing this new and exciting topic to us. But otherwise, I think we are done for the day. Thanks a lot, Radhika.
Thank you. I'm also happy to hear that if somebody wants.
Ma'am, the presentation was very nice. As in, like, we could focus on it. Because it was all in written and colorful. So thanks for that.
Thank you.
Radhika, if you share your slides with us, we'll post it on our...
Yeah, I'll email these to you.
Yeah, okay. Just wait for a few people to...
Yeah, I'm happy to stick around if people have more questions or if they want to...
Yeah, we can just hang around a little bit. So in case there are questions. Your slides are beautiful, by the way, but I'm not surprised at all knowing you.
Thank you.
Do you know, are you able to animate your handwritten slides? Are you also doing that?
No, so let me share the secret.
Are you just making multiple copies and are you just animating it?
No, okay. It's much dumber than that, but it just works beautifully. So I take a, I don't know if you saw me, but I chose this, I'm choosing this pencil, which is very thick and the same color as the background. And then I just...
So you're starting with your final slide and then you're erasing to create your previous slides and then you just play them and that's what I tried a few times and then I felt so silly doing. I mean it works beautifully. because yesterday also there was a talk where that was happening and I wasn't sure and I was like maybe somebody has cracked it finally, but okay.
No, I don't know how to I'm just erasing as we go on.
There's another question, Radhika. Can you name some source where we can read about these topics? Do you know anything off the top of your...
Well, there is a book by Thurston. I'm typing it in the chat.
Maybe something also at the undergraduate level where they can talk to learn about various geometries if there's something accessible.
Yeah. I can also try to collate that in.
Yeah.
Email,
maybe if you send us the list, we'll send it as posted on our website. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, I can. Yeah. Also the article where I got motivated to give the title of my talk, What is the Geometry of the Universe? That article was also actually interesting.
Maybe you can share that article.
Yeah. It was a Quanta magazine article.
Ah, nice. Okay, thank you so much. All right, maybe we'll wait for a minute more and then maybe we'll end the meeting. Yeah, it's a very, when the first time you see hyperbolic geometry, it's so counterintuitive. It really does blow your mind.
Yeah.
So I'm glad they brought up, go ahead.
No, I was just saying this is the first time I'm like giving a talk to undergrads on hyperbolic geometry. So it's nice to know the kind of questions people ask and like.
Really. Yeah, so we have been discussing the session that I've been holding is on discrete geometry and I've been talking about convexity and stuff. So that's why I can see where their idea is coming from. I think they've been seeing triangles and squares all week. So it was inevitable.
Okay, that's good.
I did start with warning them that there are other geometries out there. So I'm hoping that some of that stuck and today it was like reinforced.
Yeah.
So, yeah. All right. So maybe we should also give the ICTS people a break. So thanks a lot, Radhika. Yeah. And I'll see you around sometime.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
All right.
Good night.
Bye. Good night.